There are many changes that occur in someone who has type 2 diabetes that decrease the body's ability to maintain a normal blood glucose. Over the last few decades, medications have been developed to help address these changes or defects that have occurred. Today, I'd like to describe the actions of some of these medications used to treat diabetes, to discuss the potential side effects of diabetes medications, and to describe the potential for hypoglycemia with the medications used to treat diabetes, to ensure that people who are using them are aware of what to watch for. We usually group the medications that have similar actions together when we discuss the drug treatment for diabetes mellitus. The first group have a direct effect on the pancreas. There are those that have an action on the gut hormones or incretins. There's one that slows digestion of sugars and starches, and there are those that help insulin to work better. The drugs with action on the pancreas include glyburide or dibeta, glyclozide, which is dimicron or dimicron MR, glimepiride, which is amaro, repaglinide gluconorm, or nitaglinide, which is Starlix. Those with type 2 diabetes have a pancreas that cannot make enough insulin for the requirements of the body or don't release it at the appropriate time. These medications have a primary action on the body that stimulates the pancreas to release insulin into the bloodstream. They don't specifically stimulate the pancreas at mealtime. They have a somewhat continuous action, stimulating the pancreas for their length of action. When taking these, it's important to eat regular meals, not to skip any, as you can have hypoglycemia if you do. They should be taken immediately before, with, or immediately after eating the meal, never at bedtime. If you take these medications at bedtime, they may cause hypoglycemia during the middle of the night. They all have about the same effectiveness. Each of these medications acts for a certain number of hours. Glyburide, for instance, works for about 12 hours. In some people, it may work for 24. Glyclozide works for about 12 hours. The MR formulation is designed to work a full 24 hours. And glimepiride is a 24-hour drug, which means you can take it once a day. Glyburide is the one that's most likely to cause hypoglycemia and weight gain, but all of these can cause these problems. Some individuals may develop a rash. This may be a sign of a mild allergic reaction. This rash may come and go. Sometimes your doctor will have to stop the drug and prescribe a different one for you. It's a good idea to know when to check your blood glucose to see if the drugs you are taking are effective. For these three medications, it's important that you check blood glucose 2 hours after meals and fasting in the morning to see how effective this drug has been for you. Of course, you don't have to do this every day, but you should follow the directions of your healthcare provider. These drugs can cause hypoglycemia, but otherwise are generally well tolerated. Some people may experience mild nausea or diarrhea. Repaglinide, or gluconorm, and nitaglinide, which is Starlix, are designed to be taken just before you eat each meal. So that means you have to take them 3 times a day. They take care of the sugars and starches that occur from a meal because they'll work for about 4 or 5 hours, stimulating the pancreas to release insulin. After the 4 or 5 hours, it's probably time for another meal anyway, so you have to take another pill when you eat your next meal. If you miss a meal, you skip the pill. If you don't skip the pill, you will have a potential for developing hypoglycemia. You can measure the usefulness of these medications by checking the blood glucose just before and 2 hours after eating your meal. They are also very well tolerated. Rarely nausea or diarrhea can occur, and some people will develop hypoglycemia. The next group of drugs are drugs with an effect on the gut hormones called incretins. They are a new group of diabetes medications, and the first of the group was launched in 2008. These drugs act on the hormones, which we call incretins, that are released from our gut when food is ingested. Individuals with type 2 diabetes do not have a normal supply of incretin hormones in their gut. The first three drugs, with an effect on the incretins, actually lengthen the life of the naturally produced incretin hormones that are released in the gut upon ingestion of a meal. so that these incretins aren't digested too quickly or broken down too quickly and will be able to work a little longer. These drugs stimulate the pancreas to release insulin only if the blood glucose is high. They suppress the glucose secretion from the liver, but only if the blood glucose is high. And they're only used in people with type 2 diabetes. They are unlikely to cause hypoglycemia. They do not cause weight gain or weight loss, so we call them weight neutral. The first of these three drugs is sitagliptin or Januvia. It's a 100 milligram tablet that's used once a day at any time of the day, but always the same time every day. It's also available in combination with another diabetes medication called Metformin or Janumet. The most common side effect is a stuffy nose and sore throat, which usually goes away over about a month after a person has been using this medication. Rarely, a rash or hives or other allergic reaction can occur when people take this medication. Saxagliptin or Onglyza is a sister to sitagliptin. It's a 5 milligram tablet that's taken once a day at the same time every day. The most common side effects are upper respiratory infections, which resemble a cold, urinary tract infections, and or headache. Rarely, allergic reactions may occur with this medication too, and hives or rash or other allergic reactions may occur. Linagliptin or Tradjenta is the newest of the group of three. It's a 5 milligram tablet taken once a day with or without a meal. Uncommon side effects include cough, inflamed nose or throat, or allergic reactions. The next group of drugs that act on the incretin system in our bodies are drugs that actually mimic the action of incretins. They don't just lengthen the life of the naturally occurring incretins that are in the body. They actually are like incretins and mimic their action. Liraglutide or Victoza is one of these. It lowers blood glucose by increasing insulin release from the pancreas and slowing the overproduction of glucose from the liver. Its action depends on the blood glucose level. Nausea is the common side effect, but we have strategies to help reduce the nausea that may be associated with using this medication. Most practitioners will prescribe this medication at the lowest dose and slowly increase the dose over time until the desired effect has happened. It's a subcutaneous injection that's used once a day. It is not insulin, but it is given in the same manner as insulin. It is unlikely to cause hypoglycemia. This medication may aid in weight loss by slowing the stomach emptying and making you feel quite full. Therefore, you will eat less and have a lower appetite. Another medication that mimics the action of the incretins is Exenatide or Byetta. It's injected twice daily, before breakfast and at supper. It helps to lower blood glucose only if the blood glucose is high by stimulating insulin release from the pancreas and slowing the overproduction of glucose from the liver. It increases your feeling of fullness so that you are not always hungry, and in this manner may have an added effect of aiding weight loss. Nausea is the most common side effect, and again, this medication's potential to cause nausea can be eliminated or else reduced by starting with a low dose and slowly increasing the dose until the desired effect or side effects have occurred. It's unlikely to cause hypoglycemia. Another diabetes medication that's available has a very unique action. Acarbose or Glucobay slows down the digestion of certain sugars and starches. This helps the pancreas to have time to kind of catch up and take care of some of the blood glucose that will be absorbed from the meal. People with type 2 diabetes tend to not have the ability to get their pancreas to release enough insulin to take care of a meal that's normally absorbed. So slowing down the digestion of certain sugars helps to reduce the amount of glucose that gets into the bloodstream all at once. This medication does not cause hypoglycemia, so that is one advantage. It may be used in combination with other diabetes medications. However, when it is used in combination with other medications that cause low blood sugars, the low blood sugar must be treated with milk or glucose if you were to use sugar or juice, the acarbose would slow down the absorption of the sugar or juice, and you wouldn't have enough glucose available to treat that low blood sugar. A limiting factor in use of acarbose is the side effects, because many people suffer from severe gas, stomach pains or cramps, and abdominal discomfort. This may be one of the reasons why not a lot of people are using acarbose. Metformin, with the brand name Glucophage, Glumetza, and many generic products, is the most commonly used agent for diabetes mellitus. It decreases the amount of sugar production by the liver. It helps insulin to work better in the muscles. It decreases your appetite in most cases and decreases the amount of sugar that gets absorbed by the gut. The most common side effects are diarrhea and nausea, which can be managed by using strategies such as spreading out the dose over the day. If someone is taking 2 tablets at breakfast and 2 tablets at supper, we would offer the option of having that person take 1 tablet at breakfast, lunch, supper, and bedtime, spreading the 4 tablets over the day, because we feel that the diarrhea and nausea are most likely related to the amount of metformin taken at one time. We also have the strategy of prescribing a small dose at the beginning of treatment and slowly working the way up with the doses until the desired effect has occurred. Some people suffer a metallic taste which will come and go when they take metformin. There are some important other effects with metformin. It may increase fertility in certain women of childbearing age, so it's important to use contraception if pregnancy is not wanted. It also does not cause hypoglycemia, which makes it very safe to use, especially in someone newly diagnosed. Who shouldn't take metformin? Well, those with significant kidney disease, heart failure, or liver failure are not good candidates for taking metformin. Those who have mild cases of the above conditions may be able to take it with careful monitoring. This drug does not cause kidney, heart, or liver failure. However, it does accumulate when an individual has these organ failures, which can make someone very ill. We also know that those who are having an X-ray dye test should stop their metformin at least 2 days when they're having the dye test, the day of the dye test and the day after. The person having the X-ray dye test is usually given a requisition for a blood test to test their kidney function 2 days or 3 days after they have had their test, to ensure that their kidney function is still okay after the X-ray dye test, at which time the metformin can be restarted. Another group of medication are those that help insulin to work better in the muscles and liver. The two in this group are pioglitazone, which is Actos, and rosiglitazone, which is Avandia. These medications help insulin to work better in the muscles and liver, which helps to lower blood glucose. Unfortunately, they can cause fluid retention or swelling of ankles and fingers and face, and they may cause weight gain anywhere from 1 pound to 50 pounds. They also have been known to increase the risk of fractures in women. These drugs may take 6 to 12 weeks to achieve their maximum benefit, and in Canada we may use them in combination with metformin. They also may enhance fertility in women of childbearing age, so it is important to consider contraception to avoid unwanted pregnancies. These medications are unlikely to cause hypoglycemia. Avandia is also available in combination with metformin and Amaril. Who should not use pioglitazone or rosiglitazone? Well, those with significant heart failure or liver failure are not good candidates for using these medications. There has also been some controversial evidence that suggests that the Avandia may contribute to increased risk of heart attacks, so many people with heart conditions are not prescribed these medications. How do we choose the appropriate treatment for someone with type 2 diabetes? Well, we make sure that we assess their nutrition and physical activity, measure their hemoglobin A1C, which is a parameter that tells us how well their blood glucose has been managed in the last 3 months. And we ask for blood glucose patterns by having someone measure their blood glucose at home at different times of day, so we can see when their blood sugar is either high or low and how we can adjust their medication. In 1902, the treatment for diabetes was wear flannel clothing, avoid eating vegetables, and use soap suppositories. We've learned a lot about the treatment of diabetes. We know now that the needs of people who have type 2 diabetes include modifying and optimizing their nutrition and meal planning, modifying and optimizing their activity level in combination with their nutrition plans. And we know that education is a very important aspect of the treatment of diabetes, so that people who have diabetes know their different options of how to treat it and manage it. Drugs, not at the top of the list as you notice, are also a component of the treatment of diabetes. Support from healthcare professionals, family members, people who cook for people with diabetes, stress management, and self-monitoring of blood glucose are three other S's that we consider in the treatment of diabetes.